Previously, on a random video Animat made a while back.
What I'm trying to say is that I don't really want to review Equestria Girls because I know it's got to be way too much trouble to do. But honestly, I don't want to touch Equestria Girls. It's just way too much trouble for nothing. Well, thanks to the very generous pledge made by the Autistic Pony on my Patreon account, guess what he asked me to review?
My Little Pony, My Little Pony.
My Little Pony, Equestria Girls. Out of all the films out there based on My Little Pony, this one is probably the most controversial film amongst the brony community, mostly by how everybody is completely polarized about it. Bronies and Pegasisters everywhere either adore this film by giving a new twist to the franchise, as well as a loving tribute to the fourth generation of the show, or hate it with a passion because of how it resorts back to the previous girly generations. Now, for this review, I'm going to do it in the perspective of a newcomer to the modern My Little Pony franchise, since I already established a few years back that, although I admit that it's a good show and I see how people like it, it's just not my cup of tea, and thus, I'm not a brony, and the only thing I know about the show is just through my brony friends. So, if you have a problem with me reviewing this without watching the show, deal with it. But back on to Equestria Girls. Will this new human world be as magical as Equestria itself? Or does it really have a bad case of happy rainbow butterfly pony flowers? Let's find out! The story. On the surface, it doesn't really seem like anything special. It looks like your typical high school girl movie where a new girl comes in to win this competition in order to get the respect of everyone in school. And for the most part, yeah, it is. It follows the same formula and incorporates the same plot elements from beginning to end, like the scenes of awkwardly fitting into the new place, the romance with this hot guy, the evil popular girl trying to humiliate her and make her look bad, the list goes on. It makes the story pretty predictable, and some of the plot elements feel like they were added in just because it came with the high school girl story package. But what separates this from any other film with this formula is the elements of My Little Pony, which is more of a double-edged sword. On one side, it does make the film more unique, gives it a main goal for Twilight Sparkle to retrieve her crown, and the jokes of Twilight trying to get used to her new human body are pretty cute and enjoyable. On the other hand, though, there are a lot of references to the fourth generation of the show. Rather they be inside jokes or a lot of background characters that are actually human versions of secondary characters of the show. Plus the fact that the movie starts out presumably in the middle of an event of the series, it doesn't really feel welcoming to any newcomers and they would often feel lost when watching this.
If I only had some kind of party cannon that could decorate everything super fast!
I've got no idea what you're talking about!
But then comes the way the movie ended. Now, I won't spoil too much, but out of all the animated features I've seen, this is possibly the most random, out of place, and insane endings out there. And that's really saying a lot. In the last 15 minutes, the movie suddenly switched from being a cute little high school movie to a fantasy epic in a split second. It's like if in Mean Girls, they decided to conclude the movie with a giant battle in Narnia. Can't really say I expected that to happen. But despite the story being both predictable and unpredictable, it's still pretty harmless by trying to be its own thing. The animation. For something that was made as a tie-in to the TV show, I can't really say that it's bad. In fact, it's pretty good for what it is. The movie utilizes the same flash animation from the series. I wouldn't say that this type of quality is as good as most animated features out there, but it's way better done than what you'd find on YouTube or Newgrounds using Flash. As for the design of the characters, they really succeeded in looking like human versions of the ponies, while keeping the same style of the overall series. However, I do have one issue with the human designs. I get that they want the characters to look like their pony counterparts, but do they have to keep their multicolored skin tones? It feels like Twilight Sparkle entered the world of Doug and Spike will suddenly encounter Porkchop for some reason. As for the rest of the overall look of the film, there really isn't anything special. I mean, it's just a high school. Let's just say that you won't feel as immersed in the environment of the film. Sure, it's an interesting contrast compared to the fantasy world of Equestria, but don't really expect anything magical happening. Or at least until the end of the film, along with a talking dog.
Seriously? The talking dog is the weird thing about all this?
But on the plus side, it does try to do as much as it can with the animation in many of its montages and with the choreography in the cafeteria scene. The animation is pretty limited, but it definitely shows that it did as much as it can. The characters. This is probably the only time when people are actually more interesting than magical ponies. When it starts off in Equestria, all the ponies are just casually being themselves, but not introducing to newcomers who they are. They're just leaving them wondering who are they and what's going on. But then when Twilight enters the human world, that's when we meet the more interesting characters. Like the story, they're pretty generic on the surface. Twilight Sparkle is the new girl, Fluttershy is the animal-loving shy one, Pinkie Pie is the over-the-top party animal, Applejack is the cowgirl, Rarity is the fashionista, and Rainbow Dash is the tomboy sports fanatic. But what makes someone like Twilight more interesting is the My Little Pony twist, where she has to learn to be human instead of a pony while trying to show everyone the importance of friendship. As for her friends, they make them more interesting with a bit of a background to how they are in the human world and their relationship in there in contrast to how things are in Equestria. And then there's the villain of the film, Sunset Shimmer. At first, she is the generic evil popular girl that always tries to make things go her way with the help of her two bumbling minions, Snails and Snips. But with her My Little Pony twist, she actually knows about the two worlds and plots to take Twilight's crown for her own. As for the rest of the characters, they really don't matter. With the exception of Flash Sentry, who's nothing but a love interest to Twilight, everyone is just a background character to show that there are many other human versions of other ponies. They're mostly there just to make references to the show that only fans will get and have no purpose to the plot.
The great and powerful Trixie!
Need some peanut butter crackers.
Voila!
I'm sorry, what?
The characters may not seem like much at first glance, but once you know them a little more, you'll find that there's a bit of originality and charm to them. This isn't really a bad movie, nor is it really all that great either. For what it is, it's pretty harmless. I mean, it's alright. My Little Pony Equestria Girls may have set itself as a generic high school girl movie with a completely out-of-place ending, but it does offer enough originality, charm, and nice animation to bring out something that's pretty decent and enjoyable. As I stated before, because of the many inside jokes to the TV series, this is meant more to the fans of Friendship is Magic more than to bring in any newcomers to the franchise. And let's face it, guys, this is made so that Hasbro can make their version of Barbie in order to market it to little girls. Equestria Girls shares the same reasoning of existence as Disney's Planes, a movie that's meant for little kids, specifically girls, in order to sell their toys. In fact, that's what this whole franchise has been since the very beginning in the 80s, and they're still doing it today with the recent generation with a series and collection of toys all made specifically for little girls. But before any of you go on your little rants or whatever counter-arguments you can think of, I just want to say that the fact that My Little Pony is for little girls is not a problem at all. What really makes it a problem is how the bad bronies are reacting to this fact. You know the ones. The kinds that give the community a bad name to society that would take the image of the franchise a little too far, if you know what I mean. Because of how they're the opposite of a little girl and way too attached to the show, they're so close-minded that they refuse the idea that the show is not specifically targeted for them and try to completely shut down the notion. Not just that, but they try to advertise that if it's meant for little girls, then that means it's terrible. Which is why you see them bash anything My Little Pony that came before the fourth generation, and in some cases, Equestria Girls as well. But, like I said, it's not a problem if it's meant for little girls at all. I'm not trying to make you avoid My Little Pony because of who you are. If you enjoy the show, that's great, more power to ya. A guy liking My Little Pony is no different than a girl liking Transformers. Look, all I'm saying is that you can enjoy My Little Pony all you want, but don't pretend that it's not what it really is. This is not my opinion that My Little Pony is targeted for little girls. It's a fact, and you know it. But once you accept that fact, you'll learn to appreciate it even more. Because now the franchise has accomplished so much more than its purpose. Not just little girls, but everybody seems to enjoy the series, the toys, and the characters. Even grown men are in love with the franchise. If you go back in time to like 2009 and 2008, people would think you'd be insane. Sure, there are some horrible fans whose love for the ponies is a cry for serious psychological help. It's very rare that we see a small TV show based on toys suddenly grow into a phenomenon. And if that doesn't make a great series, then I don't know what does. Guys, this is Animat. Now, once again, I want to thank the Autistic Pony for his great support that he has done on Patreon, which allows him to get his request for me to do Equestria Girls. And if I can be honest, I don't really regret watching the Equestria Girls. I mean, like, you know, it's not really bad, and like, sure, it's not really meant for me, considering that it's made more for the fans with all the inside jokes and stuff like that, but like, it's decent. I didn't get angry when watching it, so it's fine. At least now that if I hang out with my brony friends and they somehow bring that up, at least I'll know what they'll be talking about. So, yeah, so, hey, it's something that I've watched, so it's pretty good. But now that I got Equestria Girls over with, it's time that we finally move on to a Patreon request. Yes, we're gonna do another one, and this time, it's going to be coming from someone by the name of Carlomon. Well, at least that's what he calls himself on his DeviantArt page. You could go check him out if you want. And also, at this point, I just want to mention that if you guys want to be like Carlomon and the Autistic Pony and go and support my work, and like, this doesn't have to be as much as they did, but if you want to pledge whatever you want and support my work, and you want to get some awesome rewards at the same time, then all you have to do is go to patreon.com/animat and go do your pledge and support my work. I'll greatly appreciate no matter what you pledge. And also, if you guys want to still suggest me an animated film you would like me to review and put on the animation hat, then write me an email at animatsreviews@gmail.com. Alright, so now that I got all that out of the way,
what did Carloman review sent me as a review? Well, he didn't really send me much of a movie. It's actually more of a legend. The story is actually something that I'm quite familiar with and I have heard of before. It's actually the story of a legendary dog, the most heroic of its kind. Well, maybe it's the only of its kind, considering he is half husky and half wolf.